Saptapanchanakorangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Deve Pranamami Hari Priye Pranamami Hari Priye Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nithananda Sri Advaita Gadadha Sri Vasati Gaur Bhakta Brinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
I am very, very grateful for this opportunity to be with all of you this evening. My special gratitude to Dr. Clooney for so kindly, with his magnanimous heart, taking the time to encourage all of us and enlighten us with his words and his very divine presence. Thank you. And to Pragya Devi, for your motherly love, your beautiful kirtan, and your very gracious words. And to Vinaya, who has so kindly been a part of the organization, so many beautiful things for us here in Harvard area. And to Richard, and to Vanamali Pandit and his family, and to all of you for coming here to Harvard University this evening. Time is so precious. How we choose to utilize each and every moment that we have is what will determine our life, our future, and how we can affect the world. Chanakya Pandit, one great Indian moralist from long ago, he explained that time is so precious that if you lose a moment, you cannot recover that for all the wealth within the cosmic manifestation. And each moment is an opportunity to grow, to progress, and to offer great things to the world. Years ago, I was in the ghettos of Calcutta, and I met with Mother Teresa. During that time with her, I especially remember particular words she spoke that deeply affected my life. She said, "The greatest problem in this world is hunger. Not hunger of the stomach, hunger of the heart. Food could fill the stomach, but only love could touch the heart." And she explained how she traveled around the world, so many places. New York, Boston, Los Angeles, London, Sydney, Paris, Bombay. And she told me that what she found was the rich, the poor, people of all classes, of all religions, of all races. Their hearts were starving. And she said to me something very interesting. Sometimes when the poorest people in the ghettos of Calcutta die in her arms, she sees a light in their eyes. She said even some of the most wealthy, powerful people in the Western world, I do not see that light in their eyes. Light of hope. She said the greatest need within the world is to feed the hunger of the heart. But we have to have it to give it. Only God's love can do that. The most fundamental need of every living being is to love and be loved. Things can give satisfaction to the body, the senses, and the mind, but only love can give fulfillment to the heart. And that's the place where real happiness, real fulfillment can be experienced. And according to the great spiritual traditions throughout history that have appeared in various places throughout the world, the origin of that love is the love of the divine, the love of God. Yoga means to reconnect, to harmonize the body, the mind, with the true self. This is the most fundamental teaching of the Bhagavad Gita. Who am I? The Gita explains, Dehi nosmin yatha dehi komaram yovaram jara tatha deham tara prabdir dhirastatra namuyate. That the body is always changing. From childhood to youth to old age. And as far as the mind, I think we all know how much the mind can change. I read a statistic by a psychologist who said that the average human being has 60,000 separate thoughts every day. One of those changes just came. Who is the witness of the changing mind and the changing body? When we see a photograph of ourselves as a little baby, we say, this was me. But the body's very different and the mind is very different. What were we thinking about then? We were crying for the milk of our mother. When was the last time you cried for the milk of your mother? The mind is very different. The body is very different, but who is that constant witness? The Gita explains it is the Atma, the living force, the spiritual essence that gives us life, that sees through the eyes, tastes through the tongue, hears through the ears, thinks through the brain, and loves through the heart. And from the Gita's perspective, there's an explanation of the nature of that Atma. Najayate mriyate vakadachin. Thank you so much. It is never born, and it can never die. It is eternal. Satchit ananda. Eternal, full of knowledge, and by its own inherent nature, full of ecstatic joy. Mamayvam so jivaloge jivabhukata bhuta sanatana. That the Atma, this living force within us, is a part of God, a part of the divine, like a sun ray is a part of the sun. And that divinity is our greatest potential. It's our greatest joy, because its inherent nature is unselfish, unmotivated love. The Srimad Bhagavat declares, Savaipung Shankaro Dharmo Yato Bhakti Ravokshaja Ahoitaki Apratihata Yayatma Supraseded. That the supreme Dharma, sometimes Dharma is translated as religion, sometimes as occupation. The supreme Dharma for all humanity is to awaken this love from within our heart and serve all living beings with that love. And that love must be without selfishness, without ego, and without interruption to actually satisfy us. I remember long ago, I read a particular verse from the Bhagavad Gita that struck me so much to the very core of everything I was looking for and longing for and praying for. When I heard this verse, I thought, that's it. Vidyavanaya sambane brahmani gavihastini suni chaiva sopaki cha pandita samadarsha. What are the qualities, according to the Bhagavad Gita's perspective, of really a learned person who is situated in knowledge? Not just how much data we can somehow or other store within our brain, but real knowledge is about our character, about our integrity. The Gita tells that a truly learned person sees every living being with equal vision. Whether one is male or female, or whether one is Hindu or Muslim or Christian or Jewish or Buddhist or Jain or Sikh or Zoroastrian or agnostic or atheist, whether one's rich or poor, from the east or from the west, whether one is a human, or an elephant, or a cow, or a dog, or a cat, wherever there is the presence of life, there is something divine, something sacred. To see that sacredness within ourselves, we are able to recognize it in all others. Long ago, I lived on the bank of the Ganges River, and there was an old man. He was about 85 years old. His name was Narayan Prasad. And at the time, I had just come out of my teens. I was just 20. And he was a devotee of Lord Rama, a Hindu, very, very religious, very learned also. And I would spend many hours with him every day. And each day at 11 o'clock in the morning, he took me to a place called the Magadha X-ray Clinic. And there, for at least an hour, we had a discussion with a man named Mohammed, who followed the Islamic faith. It was very interesting, because Mohammed would share his realizations of the Holy Quran, and Narayan Prasad would share his realizations and experiences of the Ramayana and the Bhagavad Gita. And little me, I would share my experiences of all the clutter of stuff that I had accumulated from the Bible, the Old Testament, the New Testament, and whatever else I was reading. But the incredible thing about this exchange, it wasn't about tolerating our differences, somehow or other, not fighting about them. In my young, impressionable mind, I saw something between these two very saintly people in my eyes. They deeply appreciated each other's views. They felt that they were being enriched by each other's views. And one day when I was sitting alone with the Hindu, Narayan Prasad, on the bank of the river, I asked him a question. I said, in a country like India, where there is so much conflict between Hindus and Muslims, there's so much violence and communalism, how is it that the two of you could be best of friends? I'll never forget his reply. He said, if a dog has a master, the dog will recognize the master in whatever way the master dresses. One day, he may be in a tuxedo. Another day, in blue jeans and t-shirt. Another day, in a bathing suit. Another day, he may be naked. But the dog recognizes the master in any dress. If we cannot recognize our beloved Lord, our source, our origin, the object of our deepest love, when he comes to different people, at different times, in different places, in different dresses, then we have so much to learn from the dog. Professor Clooney was speaking about this book, The Journey Home. May I tell you something about that? I really never wanted to write this, but my very, very dearest friend on his deathbed, he made me promise to write it and publish it. So I did. I never thought myself to be an author or anything like that, but if we just try our best, that's good enough. And what comes out of it is in the hands of a power beyond our own. As Dr. Clooney said, we were both from the same era, and Pragyadevi also. I was born in 1950, and at 4 years old, my family moved from Chicago to a little suburb named Highland Park in northern Illinois. And it was a very peaceful place, playing in the empty lots, baseball, football, watching television, going to school. But then something happened. I became a teenager in the 1960s. And suddenly, things didn't make sense the way they used to. I was working a job because my father was having financial struggles when I was 15. And except for a couple of my close friends, everyone else that worked with us were African Americans, who were the age of my father. They would come down from the south side of Chicago every day to work. And I loved them, and they loved me. We were really close, but I couldn't understand why. They have no alternative than to live and die in poverty, with racial discrimination, with no real chance of prosperity or acceptance within society. In a country that promises freedom to everyone, Why is the social position of people of America so different from our laws? At the same time, the Vietnam War was raging. And I wasn't such a good student. I knew when I turned 18, I may be drafted and sent to a war. And some of my older friends who didn't believe in the war, they had the choice of either being sent to jail or sent to fight and kill or be killed for something they don't believe. Some of them came back from Vietnam in wooden boxes, killed. Others, due to the emotional stress, they were drug addicts, alcoholics, or they had permanent injuries. How could the idyllic life in Highland Park satisfy me when so much was going on in the world? The music of the 60s very strongly influenced the younger generation to question and to rebel. And like so many others, I joined the counterculture. With a passion, I joined the civil rights movement, Martin Luther King. I read the books of Malcolm X. I remember demonstrating in one civil rights march in Florida and having bottles, stones, tomatoes, and curse words hurled at me by my white brothers and sisters. And I remember in 1968 in Grant Park in Chicago, I was just gathered there to talk to people to find out really what's happening in this world. And I was tear gassed by a whole army of club swinging Chicago police who I was told were protecting my freedom. What's happening? Little by little, I came to know that if I really want to find the answer, I have to find it first in myself. I heard the words, if you do not have an ideal that you're willing to die for, you have nothing really meaningful to live for. And I heard those striking words of Mahatma Gandhi, be the change that you want to see in the world. I was starting to see that the counterculture had the same inner problems as what we were revolting against. There was hatred. There was judgmentalism. So more and more, I started searching for spirituality. I was going to churches and reading the Bible, going to synagogues, reading the Torah, the Kabbalah. I started studying books of Eastern wisdom. And from those very early teenage years, I remember having the conclusion in my own mind that there must be something common in the essence of all of these. How is it that in the name of a one loving God, there is so much division and hatred? Either we reject it all, or we become sectarian, or we really seek the essence. I remember reading the words of Jesus, where he told to some leaders, religious leaders, that you understand the letter of the law, but you do not understand the spirit and the power behind it. I needed to find that. It was about that time that my best lifelong friend Gary called me to someone's house in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And Gary said, "I'm going on a summer trip to Europe. You must come." I said, "I have no money. I have a job for the summer. I can't." Gary said, "I have no money either." "But Frank, our friend, is willing to pay for both of us. So let's go." I said, "I'll go." It sounded really nice. It sounded like some divine arrangement. So we took an airplane to Iceland, and because there was no volcano at the time, we got a connecting flight to Luxembourg. And then we discovered what kind of trip Frank was going to take us on. The first night, we were all three crammed in a tiny little tent in a campground. And the next morning, Frank was robbed and said, "We have to go back. We can't survive with nothing." And he left. And Gary and I just looked at each other and went, "It doesn't make any difference to us." So we hitchhiked. We associated with the counterculture. We went to rock festivals. But little by little, there was a call in my heart that was just taking me away from all of it. I found myself sitting on the banks of rivers, in synagogues, in cathedrals, in monasteries, trying to go deeper and deeper to understand who I am. How can I really be an instrument of peace and goodness within this world? This little spark of spiritual desire became like a flame and ultimately took Gary and I to the island of Crete, off the coast of Greece, where we lived in a cave together. And every day from sunrise to sunset, I sat on top of a mountain and meditated and prayed and studied spiritual books. One day, I was weeping. I was praying for direction. When something happened that changed my life forever, I heard three words. And I understood if I follow what these three words are saying, I could never turn back. "Go to India." I had never met an Indian. I had never had Indian food. I didn't know where India was. I didn't have a map, and I couldn't even afford one. I had nothing. I climbed down that mountain back to the cave, and Gary was sitting there in meditation with a little candle burning beside him. I said, "Gary, something incredible happened to me." Gary said, "Something amazing happened to me." I said, "What?" He said, "At sunset, I heard a voice." I said, "What did he say?" He said, "You won't believe me." "I might. I really might." He said, "I don't think you're going to believe me." I said, "Just tell me." He said, "I heard a voice tell me, go to Israel." I slid closer. I said, "What? Where? Where?" He said, "I told you you wouldn't believe me." I said, no, I believe you, but where?" He said, I said, no, I didn't hear, where? He said, "Israel. We should both go to Israel." I said, "Gary, he told me to go to India." Gary said, "India?" There was complete silence for about 20 minutes. I remember looking out at the stars in the darkened sky, glistening over the Mediterranean Sea. and silently whispering into the sky, I am willing. Then I turned to Gary and said, at sunrise, I'm leaving for India. He said, there is no way I'm going to hitchhike across the Middle East. This is insane. It's dangerous. Come to Israel with me. We'll work on a kibbutz. We'll make money. Then we'll get a bus to India. I said, Gary, I believe this was the call of God. I have to go at sunrise. He said, you're going to leave me all alone on this island? I didn't reply. He understood my heart. And the next morning I began my journey. My first hitchhiking ride was on a fishing boat from the island to Athens. I remember looking at the choppy sea, wondering where destiny was going to lead me. We hitchhiked through Turkey and Iran, Afghanistan and Pakistan. I remember when I was in Iran, I remembered that I was supposed to go back to college. Months ago. And my parents were waiting for me. I told them I was just going on a summer vacation, and they worried a lot. They were so protective. For those of you who are parents, you may sympathize. I was supposed to be back in the end of August. 2 months, 3 months. Now, it's the end of October, they heard nothing from me. Then they got a letter telling that Gary's no longer with me. I've seen life through the eyes of a Western man for 19 years. Now I want to see through the window of the vision of people of the East. What education could be better than this? Personal experience. I thought they'd be so proud of me. I said, I'm hitchhiking to India. I knew I was breaking their hearts. And then I ended the letter with words that I'm sure fell on totally deaf ears. Please, do not worry. It was postmarked Iran with no return address. I remember when I was in a place called Kandahar, Afghanistan. I was sitting in a little tea stall. Interestingly, myself and almost every world traveler in that counterculture of world travelers who had no money in those days, we all really loved the people of Afghanistan. They were so hospitable and so kind, although so poor materially. I was sitting in a little shack that was a tea shop. There was no chairs. Everyone was squatted down with a little glass of tea. Maybe five of us, six of us. And then this boy came in. He was about 16 years old. He was in total poverty. He was wearing filthy rags on his body, very much torn up. He was extremely skinny and looked really malnutritioned. But the worst part is he was blind. His eyes were swollen, disfigured, and had nothing covering them. I never saw anything like that. My heart quaked. and he had a little tree branch that he was holding, and there was a tin can nailed to one end, and then a string, a wire that was stretched across and nailed to the other end. And he played it as a musical instrument. It wasn't very acoustically professional. It was just like bung, bung, bung. And as he played, he sang these hymns that were just pouring from the core of his heart. And as I was looking at him, I saw his face literally was illuminated with joy. There was a smile with his rotten teeth inside. That was perhaps the most blissful smile I ever saw. We all sat there mesmerized for about 45 minutes as he sang and he sang and he sang. And I remember thinking at that time, he looks like the happiest person I've ever met in my life. And yet he's in total poverty, he's in disease, he's illiterate. Everything that I have been taught my whole life will make you happy, he has none of it, and he's happier than all the people who have it. This was a culture shock to me. What really is meaningful and fulfilling life? Is it about things? Or is it about an inner experience? That was a great lesson. It took me 6 months hitchhiking from London to the border of India. And when I got to the border, they wouldn't let me in because they had no money. That was really a struggle. You have to read the book if you want to know how I got here. I'd like to just share a couple stories. Earlier this year, I called my father. At the time, he was 86 years old. Now he's 87. I asked the common question, "My dear father, how are you?" He said, usually he's always so positive and he's always so cheerful, but this time with a very grave, stern voice, he answered with one word, "Terrible." That shocked me. I've never heard him say that before. I said, "What happened?" He said, "I didn't sleep all night." I said, "Why didn't you sleep?" "I read your book, The Journey Home, before I went to sleep." I said, "Was it that bad?" He said, "It was worse." I said, "Well, which part did you read?" He said, "I read the part where you were sinking in quicksand." And he went on and on to explain the situation. Would you like me to tell you the story? During my journey to India, the first day I came to the Himalayas, I was alone sitting on the bank of the Ganges, meditating in a very secluded place. And out from a jungle came a holy man, and he walked right up to me and said, "You don't know me, but I know you. Now take off your Western clothes and throw them in the Ganges, and I will give you the robes of a sadhu." I said, "What is a sadhu?" He said, "A sadhu is a homeless wanderer who is seeking divinity. Or you may say a monk." He had just two strips of cloth, unsewn cloth. I said, those are, I was thinking, those are clothes. Anyways, this seems to be some divine arrangement. So I took off my only clothes I had. Because escaping from people who were trying to murder me in the Middle East, I left my sleeping bag and my bags and all my clothes behind. So I just have one shirt and one pair of pants. And when that's all you have, you become really attached to them. It becomes a part of your identity. I'm sorry if I'm getting a little too emotional here, but those pants were gray with thin black pinstripes going vertically down them. And I thought they were so cool. And I had a turtleneck shirt which was gray with horizontal pinstripes. And he told me to throw them in the Ganges, so I took them off and threw them in the Ganges. They were gone forever. Then he told me how to wrap this little sheet around my waist and another sheet around the upper part of my body. Then he had two other little strips. He said, these are called kopan, loincloth. Throw your underpants in the Ganges. This was becoming serious surrender. Fruit of the loom, underpants. Gone forever. And then he whispered something in my ear. He said, the Ganges will become your mother. She will reveal this to you in time. He turned around and walked away, and I never saw him again. From that point, I wandered the Himalayas, sometimes in caves, sometimes on riverbanks, in the forests, living with yogis and sages and rishis, and sometimes just all by myself. And at one point, I came to a clearing in the jungle. It was just the end of the winter of 1971. It was in about February of 1971. I was shocked by what I saw. There were people who were in absolute depressed condition. Some were naked. Some were in rags. They were without homes. Some of them, to protect from the cold, they dug holes in the ground and covered themselves with dirt. And many of them, their faces and their whole bodies, the flesh was decomposed and shriveling and deformed. Some had no noses or no fingers or no toes. I had stumbled into a leprosy colony. When they saw me, a Western person, about 15 or 20 of them made a tight circle around me and wouldn't let me move and screamed into my face, bakshish, bakshish, which means give me money. I didn't have any money. I would have loved to have given them money, but they didn't believe me. They went tighter and tighter and tighter. They were even fighting among themselves to get in the front, to get some money from me. Screaming with desperate eyes, bakshish, bakshish. As they were screaming, they were spitting in my face and putting their deformed hands in my face. It was a culture shock for someone brought up in the suburbs of Chicago. There were so many thoughts in my mind. Part of my mind was thinking, why are they doing this to me? How cruel. Another part was thinking, the way they're suffering, anything they do is justified. And another part was thinking, I don't know much about leprosy, but I heard it's contagious, and they're spitting in my face, and they're putting their bloody hands in my face, and I might get leprosy. So it was quite a traumatic experience. They had me like a prisoner there for about 20 minutes, and finally they patted me down, kind of like what people are revolting against in the airports these days. You were like the leprosy colony TSA. And they found that I really had nothing. So they let me go. I walked a few steps and stopped in my tracks. To my left side, I saw a very old leper woman. Her face was really deformed, and there was practically a hole where the nose was supposed to be. It was pitiful to see her. She just laid there in the dirt in rags. She looked in my eyes, and I looked in hers. I felt the compassionate love of a mother in her glance. It was as if she was speaking to me through her eyes, how she felt so much sympathy for what I just went through, the anxiety that her people caused to me. And then I saw in her eyes a heart that had been yearning and longing to love someone and for someone to accept the love she so badly wanted to give. She then offered her pranams, her greetings to me, and then with one hand she put it out to bless me. The motherly affection I felt in her eyes affected me so much that I ran over to her, fell on my knees, and put my head under her hand to receive her blessing. And that old leper woman repeated again and again in the Hindi language the words, "May God bless you, my child. May God bless you. May God bless you." I looked up at her. She had no teeth in her mouth, but she was smiling. And through those deformed, sunken eyes, I saw tears streaming. Her face was lit up with the joy of giving what every mother wants and needs to give, a blessing to a child, which she perhaps never had the chance to do for decades. She was in a type of ecstasy, blessing me. And I remember very clearly, as if it was this morning, looking at her face, I was thinking, she is the most beautiful person I've ever seen. What really is beauty? After some time, I left her and went higher into the mountains and sat on the banks of a river and looked at the surface of the river. And I was thinking, what do I see of the river? It's just what's on the surface, but deeper down, there's so much more. What do we see in people? Why are people the way they are? If we really go deep, then instead of feeling hate or anger toward people, we'll probably feel compassion. This leper woman was ugly and diseased, but all she wanted to do is love someone and receive someone's love. saint named Ananda Mahima. She told me that love is everlasting forgiveness. God sends suffering so that we will turn to Him and end all suffering. We should see every situation as a positive opportunity to grow. So I'm going to fast forward to this section of the book my father was reading. What happened is, I came down from the Himalayas and I came to a place called Prayag, which is where Professor Clooney, thank you so much for your kind comments. There, it's considered one of the holiest places in all of India, where the Ganges, the Jamuna, and the Saraswati rivers all meet. It was the summertime, and the sand was very hot, and I was the only person around. And I was sitting on the sand, and I was really getting burnt by it, and thinking, this is the place of the Kumbh Mela, where every 12 years, up to 20 or 30 million people come to bathe. It's so holy and sacred, and to meet saintly people. And I'm here. I walked miles and miles to get to that place. And I went in the water. Oh, it was so nice. It was so cool. It was so refreshing. The river Ganges was forcefully flowing in one direction, and the river Jamuna was flowing very, very gently into the Ganges. And I said some prayers, and I was thinking, it's so cool, and it's so nice in this water, and it's so hot out there, and this is such a holy place, and I may never be back here for the rest of my life. I'm going to stay in this water as long as I can. And then I got an enthusiasm to swim all the way across. Now, the easiest way to swim across is just to swim with the current of the Ganges, because she was going really fast. So it was over 100 yards I swam across. I was carried by the Ganges to this riverbank that was absolutely secluded. There was nothing and no one anywhere around. And I was thinking, what a blessing to be in such a quiet place to meditate. So I got out of the Ganges, and I stepped into the sand and found myself getting sucked down. I was really disoriented. I pulled my foot out, and as soon as I put it back on, my other foot started sinking down. I was going deeper and deeper until I was almost to my knees. I was being devoured by Mother Earth. I realized I was in quicksand. As I was struggling to get out, frantically struggling, but as I struggled, I kept going down and down. And I realized I couldn't get out. The more I struggled, the deeper I was going. Then I looked around for something to grab onto, and some little distance away I saw a bush with no leaves on it. And I plunged toward it and grabbed it and pulled it. It was a thorn bush. It was cutting into my hands like razors, and I was bleeding and... But I had two choices, either tolerate these little swords cutting my hand, or be devoured by the earth. So I pulled and I pulled and I pulled and I started coming out and I started coming out, and then suddenly, the whole thorn bush with its rotten roots sprung right out of the sand into my hand. Threw it down. I had nothing. I was squirming. I was alone. and it probably was about 110 degrees sun. And when I was just about to give up because of exhaustion, I kind of relaxed. And I discovered when I relaxed, I wasn't sinking anymore. So if I just relax, the quicksand doesn't pull me down. So I kind of laid back and didn't move, and I floated, and little by little by little I lifted each leg to get out, and then like a snake I slowly slid back into the river and started swimming back to where I came from. But the river Ganges was flowing very strong right back into the quicksand. I was struggling, swimming with all my might because I knew swimming. Should I tell you a little about my past of swimming? When I was a little boy, it was a big thing to go to swimming tournaments at the public pools. And different friends would practice like anything to win those tournaments. Should I tell you which stroke I was the champion? Not the breaststroke or the butterfly or the crawl or any of those things or the backstroke. I won the contest for the dog paddle. You know what the dog paddle is? You don't really go anywhere. You just kind of go like this. And because the dog paddle, you just kind of go like this, all the other strokes, people are swimming back and forth, and I didn't even bother because I couldn't win those things. But I went like this, and whoever wins the dog paddle is the person who just does it the longest. And all the other children were just so bored with it that they got out. So by default, I was the dog paddle champion of my neighborhood. Anyway, I didn't know how to swim, so I was swimming, and it wasn't a dog paddle then because the Ganges was pushing me back to the quicksand where I was going to die. I got a little forward. But then I couldn't go any further. I was so tired. I was absolutely exhausting. I was like swimming. My arms felt like they were being paralyzed. My lungs were pumping desperately. And I couldn't even see the other side. I was so far away. And as I was, as hard as I could, swimming, I was being pushed back toward the quicksand. I was hopeless. I was praying for a higher power beyond myself because I didn't have any power to save myself. And I saw, about 200 feet away, there was a little boat, a fishing boat. It was like a canoe. And there was one really old, shriveled up man with big white beard and a red turban, who was rowing the boat, coasting along the Yamuna's current. And I was screaming out to him. But you know, there's a lot of noise with a strong current of the river. I was swimming and screaming, praying that he would hear me. And finally, he heard me, and he looked at me. And I was crying, help, you know, help. And he just looked and smiled and went like this. He just moved his hand in a forward direction and then floated by and left me there to drown. I was thinking, what kind of, you know, I'm praying to God and here's somebody and he just, it's the end. I had no more strength. I started going underwater, swallowing water. And I felt I had two choices. Either die in the holy river Ganges or die in the quicksand. I decided that the Ganges is better. So I was still trying, but there was no hope. And I started going underwater. when I lost all hope and I just prayed and I was underwater, something happened. A beautiful song came into my mind. It was the Hare Krishna mantra. When I first was living on the bank of the Ganges, I first heard this mantra in the current of the Ganges, this beautiful song, and it became a very much a part of my heart. I heard it again, and I started chanting in my mind, repeating this mantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And in that mantra, I felt such peace, such a fearlessness, such a calmness, that it was just such a blessed way to die. I felt, instead of fear, I felt gratitude. And just then, with the clarity of mind that I had, I thought, why did that old man go like that? Now I understand. He was telling me, don't swim against the current of the Ganges this way. Swim with the gentle current of the Jamuna this way. Why didn't I think of that? So instead of swimming against the Ganges current, I started swimming this way across the Ganges current. And as I was swimming, I was thinking, but way back, I'm going the opposite direction from where I came from, and that's where my passport is. And that's all I had. And then I remember thinking, you know, for most people, to lose their passport's a really stressful situation. But compared to losing your life, I was thinking, who cares if I lose my passport? At least I'll live to lose it. So I was happy. And I had to go maybe a mile before I could finally get out of the river. And it took me hours and hours and hours to get back to where I was from the other side. I remember there were hundreds and hundreds of people, because it was evening, that were bathing in the Ganges. And my passport was still there. I was sitting on the sand, thinking, this sand is so cool, and it's giving me such shelter. Then I was analyzing the nature of sand. That the same sand that's now so cool and such a comfortable place for me to sit. Earlier in the day, it was burning hot. I couldn't tolerate it. And then in another place, the same kind of sand was sucking me down to suffocate me and kill me. How sand is so influenced by its surroundings. And isn't that like human nature? According to the company we keep, according to the experiences we have in the circumstances of our life, how it could make us envious or proud of somebody. How it can make us angry or forgiving. Mean or kind, just due to circumstances, like the sand. But I remember sitting on that same little bank and seeing an experience that I often tell people. May I share it? While I was sitting on that bank, I happened to see a hawk circling high above me, his brown reddish feathers shining in the sun. He came lower and lower and lower until until this hawk was just a few feet above my head. I looked up at him, wondering, what's he gonna do? He was a big hawk. His glistening yellow eyes intently gazed into the river. Suddenly, he dove headlong into the river of Ganges. And there was an underwater skirmish going on. It was flapping and flapping and flapping. And I didn't know what was happening. Water was splashing. And suddenly, the hawk emerged with a 1-foot fish pierced by his claws. And I looked at that fish. I don't know if it was a boy or a girl. But whatever he or she was totally bewildered as the hawk took him far away into the forest. And I was thinking that poor little fish was just going about its routine day like any other day. You know, probably playing around with fish friends and family friends, looking for some food and going upstream and downstream and just living a happy fish life. When suddenly, at the least expected moment, this yellow-eyed hawk of faith ripped him right out of his comfort zone. And how much we are similar to that fish, just going about our routine lives, quite complacent to the reality that the hawk of fate could create crisis, drama, at any moment. Rip us out of our comfort zone. We read about it. We see it on television. We know people who've gone through it. How important it is to really focus our attention on what is really meaningful and fulfilling and important in life. My beloved Guru, Srila Prabhupada, he said our tendency is we become so much entangled with unnecessary necessities. Somebody had written, you can never get enough of what you don't really want. What do we really want? Do we really focus on that? And then I was thinking that if that fish swam deeper in the river, the hawk could not reach it. And similarly, if we go deeper into our own inner selves, if we go deeper into the real meaning and purpose of life, which is within us, then whatever may happen in this world, we can deal with it with a clear mind, but we're not affected. Why are we not affected? The Bhagavad Gita tells, Vishayada nivartante niraharasya dehina rasavarajam rasofyasya param drisva nivartate. Because within the heart, within the soul, is deep fulfillment, spiritual fulfillment. When we connect to that, then we could deal with all of the inevitable dualities of this world with a sober mind. We can actually find love and be instruments of compassion in our lives, and not be affected so much by the self, by the inevitable changes that come around us. And that is what yoga means. To actually reconnect with our own essence. And the word religion comes from the Latin word religio, which means to bind us back to our own true essence. In the Bible it is said, what is the use if you gain the whole world if you lose your eternal soul? Be in this world, but not of this world. Real happiness is not about what we can grab from outside, thinking we need more and more and more and more. Because we can never get enough of what we don't really want. Real happiness is finding the joy of our own connection to the divinity within our own hearts and sharing that by giving it out. Yes, if we swim deeper, we can find true fulfillment and be an instrument of that fulfillment. And I was thinking in terms of this episode I just had gone through. I didn't plan to get caught in quicksand. I didn't plan to drown in a river. But it all just happened. But by chanting this mantra, I actually tuned in, as Vinayaji was saying, tuned in to a higher reality, to a spiritual essence that connected me. And I found peace, fulfillment, knowing the eternal nature of who I was. It was beautiful. So these are a few stories that were very transformational that I felt were appropriate to speak according to the topic I was given tonight. Eventually, I came to a place called Vrindavan. I was on my way somewhere else. I was on this train that was in an agricultural field that flooded due to monsoon rains, and we were in one place for 25 hours. There were 200 people in a compartment that held 60. And when we finally started to move, I got out of the train at a station just to drink some water and breathe some air and to move. And then the train left and I couldn't get back on. It was too crowded. So I asked people, where am I? And they said, this is Mathura, the birthplace of Krishna. And today is Janmashtami, Krishna's birthday. I decided I'll stay here for a couple days and go on to my destination. But then I got typhoid fever the day I was supposed to leave. So I was stuck in this place. And the beauty of the people and the environment so much charmed my heart. It's the place of pilgrimage, especially for those who practice bhakti yoga. The yoga that specifically aims at opening the love of the heart and being an instrument of that love in our life. The love of God and love for every living being. Because when we love God, we see everyone as our neighbor and love them as ourselves. It's a universal principle. I found bhakti to be so much the essence of all real spiritual paths. So I decided to stay there. And at one point I met this one very simple old man. His name was Ghanashyam. He was in his 70s. I was then about 20 going on 21. He found these deities of Krishna. In India, people worship deities and believe that God accepts our love and our devotion through these forms when it's offered with sincerity. So he had these deities, and he was a homeless man. He found them underground. Beautiful story how that happened. He worshiped them under a tree, and one family said, you could use our closet and worship them there. So he slept in the family's home hallway outside the closet and did his devotion in the closet for 50 years by the time I went to see him. His humility and his sincerity, so much charm in my heart. He was just such a simple man. He wasn't a scholar. He was just nice. So every day I would go to him. And one night I went, it was in the winter. And as I was leaving, he said, "Where do you sleep tonight?" I said, "I sleep on the bank of the river Yamuna every night." He said, "No, no, it is too cold. You must sleep here tonight." I said, "I sleep there every night, Ganesham." He said, "No, no, tonight you sleep here." I said, "It's not so cold." He said, "It's very, very cold. You sleep here." It was actually very cold that night. So I said, "All right." So he gave me this old threadbare blanket. And he said, "You sleep with this blanket." On the floor, of course, because he slept on the floor. I said, "Where's your blanket?" He said, "No need, no need." I said, "This is your blanket. You only have one blanket. You're giving me your blanket. You use this blanket." He said, "No need, no need." I said, "You're an old man. I'm young. I'm not going to take your blanket away from you." He said, "No need, no need." I said, "Then I'm going back to the riverbank." And I started walking away. He said, "I will take the blanket." So I laid on the floor, and he laid on the floor and put the blanket over him. Now, for some yogis, I learned a special asana of how to keep warm in the winter when you sleep on the ground. What you do is you curl up as tight as you possibly can. You just crunch your body into a little ball, and the energy of doing that produces a little bit of heat. And when you're desperate, a little is a lot. So I curled up real tight. It was really cold, and I fell asleep. A few minutes later, I woke up, and I looked over, and there was old Ganesham laying there without a blanket. And he was trembling, violently trembling, like a leaf in a windstorm. And I was feeling kind of warm. I was wondering what's happening. Then I looked on top of myself. As soon as I fall asleep, he put his blanket over me. So I took that blanket and very, very quietly went to put it back on Ganesham. As soon as I touched him, he jumped up. "No need, no need." I said, "Ganesham, you're freezing." He said, "No need, no need. I am not cold. I am very happy." I said, "You take this blanket." He said, "No, you use this blanket." And I said, "Then I'm leaving." He said, "All right, I will take the blanket." And I went to sleep. And I woke up a few minutes later. And I was a little warm. And I looked over, and there was Ganesham with no blanket. And he put it back on me. And we did this all night. Ganesham's mood. He would tell me. He said, "To serve God means to serve every living being. To serve God means to serve those who God loves. And God loves everyone." And he told me that there's no greater pleasure that he experiences than undergoing difficulty to serve others in God's name. And he meant it. In this book, I tell several stories about Ganesham. And I learned something about humility. Humility is not a weakness. It's not self-effacement. It doesn't lead to depression. Depression is not humility. Depression is a frustrated ego. Humility is to be without ego. To actually see that there's a higher power than ourselves that is at work, and to be an instrument of that power without selfishness, without ego. That's humility. And that type of humility liberates us and brings the ultimate joy, because it opens our hearts to receive grace. I found that in Ghanashyam. He was a simple man that simply loved God and loved everyone. And it was there in Vrindavan that I met my Gurudev, Srila Prabhupada. And I saw in him a humility to just be an instrument of grace. I read about him when I was there, how at the age of 70 he crossed over 2 oceans and 3 continents on a cargo ship with only $7. And came to New York City just to share a universal message of pure, unalloyed love for God with others. And the awakening of that love through the bhakti process is in using whatever we have and whatever we know in a mood of seva or service. And to tune in to that divinity within us through these chanting of mantras and associating with people who enlighten us. And I just wanted to help him in his mission of selfless compassion. I personally found in his wisdom not something that negated other spiritual ideas or religions, but a teaching that really integrated them all. And dove deeply into the essence of unmotivated, uninterrupted, loving service. And since that time, I've been trying to assist him in sharing this great wisdom with others. Meanwhile, through all this traveling, my poor mother and father, they get letters, and I included the letters in this book. I thought that they would, I knew they were suffering, but I thought they would feel I was so special. I'd write to them saying, I'm living in the caves of the Himalayan jungles, and I'm looking and learning so many beautiful truths from the leopards and the cobras and the scorpions. And I was thinking, they're going to think I'm such a, proud son. But they simply suffered. But when I came home, it was time to apply these principles in another way, without judgment, to really appreciate and be grateful for who they were. And I found if I could do that, they could also appreciate and be grateful to who I was. Became so close. They came to India 3 times. And when my mother passed away, my whole family decided we will cremate her body. Something that's never been done in our family tradition from the time of Abraham, as far as I know. And the reason they cremated her is to give me the ashes to bring to India, because they felt she was so proud of what her son was doing there. That meant a lot to me. I brought her ashes back, and in the banks of the Ganges, the same Ganges who became my mother, who nourished me with her waters, who nourished me with so much wisdom, who nourished me with mantras. On the bank of the Ganges, there was over 2,000 devotees of ours, all chanting beautiful prayers for my mother's soul. As I offered her ashes of her body into the Ganges, And I remember thinking, this is really what bhakti yoga is, to harmonize our physical, our emotional, and our spiritual in one as an offering to God. And here today, my material mother and my spiritual mother are becoming one. And I remember praying with tears in my eyes, praying to God, who we call Krishna, all attractive. My Lord, please carry my beloved mother's soul to the sea of your grace and bless her. Thank you very much. Questions or kirtan?
No.
Whoever the organizers are, I am your puppet, and you can pull my string.
20. Yeah.